there. It is a wet, snowy day outside. I've got some tea, and it's story time. So once upon a time, about 200 years ago, this guy named Fresnel came up with an idea that would later be called the invention that saved a million ships. It was called the Fresnel lens, and it completely transformed the way lighthouses worked around the world. These things were also works of art, to the point where, despite being built about two centuries ago, we can't perfectly replicate them today. What really gets me, though, is that even if you have never been to a lighthouse, I'm willing to bet you've encountered a Fresnel lens before. Depending on when you were born, there's even a chance they've saved your life on the road. Because sure, Fresnel lenses have been the heart and soul of lighthouses around the world for decades. But the engineering behind this 1800s technology has also been adapted for everything from headlights to spacecraft. And the best part? This is not just a video about how Fresnel lenses work and how significant they are. It's also a field trip. Because this fall, I got to visit a Great Lakes lighthouse that still owns their original Fresnel lens, and I got to learn about it from a pretty incredible person, a lighthouse keeper named Nick Korstad. So, let's take a field trip to Big Bay Point. Nick is the only lighthouse keeper at Big Bay Point Lighthouse, which means he knows the ins and outs of this place incredibly well. He's also the owner, which meant I had some questions for him, including but not limited to, how does a young person come to own a historic lighthouse? Because it wasn't passed down in the family.
So lighthouses have always just been a thing since I was a child. So I grew up on the West Coast. Cool. We had lighthouses around us with lighthouse keepers still. That was a job that was dissipating very quickly. And so I just went to college and did my thing working for hotels and moved up. And after the last recession, it was like, you know, I think I'm gonna buy one of these auctioned off lighthouses, see if I can start a business with it. But my end goal was one on land, you know, but when I was 24 years old at the time, I couldn't afford the price tag for this. So I was the first person to start flipping offshore lighthouses.
Oh.
And then I flipped to get to this one. And so thankfully I was able to get it at the right time in the market. But it's actually two homes, so it's a duplex. Okay. And it allows me to have a side and a side for it to generate income.
If you're curious, I have not yet rented a room at the lighthouse, but you can bet it is on my list. Regardless, the history of Big Bay Point Lighthouse stretches back way before Nick. The building was completed in 1896, and over the years, it was managed by about 50 lighthouse keepers and assistants until the light was automated in 1941. The building is designed to cast a beam of light 28 miles to the horizon, which allows it to fill a gap of darkness between two other lighthouses, one on Granite Island and one on the Huron Islands. That way, any ship that's traveling near the coast will have a reference point and also won't crash into the sandstone that makes up Big Bay Point. Historically, mariners would always know they were passing this lighthouse because it was a fixed light that was always shining, and then it would flash every 20 seconds. Or during the day, they could look for this red brick tower with either a white or a black lantern room, depending on the year. These days, Big Bay Point Lighthouse isn't run by the Coast Guard, but it is still serving a role here.
To this day, the local ore ship, steamship authority does use the lighthouse. We are a marking station on Lake Superior. We do have the brightest light.
Cool.
And every 20, 30 minutes, the ships do have to mark a paper chart. And that's not because they're using the lighthouse to find the way, but if they were to lose power, they would be able to contact the Coast Guard and tell them at what time they marked Big Bay Lighthouse. And the Coast Guard helicopter from Traverse City would come out and be able to locate the ship and make sure that, you know, nothing happens.
Now, there is so much I could have included in this video. Nick and I had a genuinely wonderful chat about lighthouses and lighthouse keepers and the challenges of maintaining a historic building on one of the largest, most violent lakes on the planet.
This is my third flagpole.
Oh my gosh.
This one has made it almost a year now.
If you're interested in things like that, please do let me know in the comments, and I'll look into making an extended cut of this video. But for now, let's head up to the lens room and get to the bottom of this whole Fresnel thing.
But here we have, this is our original lens to our lighthouse.
Holy size, Batman, that's neat.
It's a cool piece of history, and you know, I'm able, when I do clean it, I cleaned it last week, you are able to actually get inside, stand up, and you don't touch the top. Okay. I still have to reach up to clean all the prisms. And I'm, you know, just very lucky and fortunate to still have this on site. Fresnel lenses came in 7 different sizes.
Okay.
1 through 6 was used here in the US. And then there was one other size that It's more common in Europe. It's called a hyper-radiant Fresnel lens. Oh. Ours is the third order, and this was manufactured by Henri Lepeau. And Henri Lepeau and Chance Brothers were the two main lens manufacturers, but there were other people that came into the picture. But Henri Lepeau was contacted by U.S. Lighthouse Service to make a very frugal lens. So this third order beehive was designed for the Great Lakes region. And that's why they're so highly sought after by museums, because they did start using them throughout the world. But this is a very cheap design. If you look at a lot of Fresnel lenses, you go to Europe, they might have crazy, like a square side and then like three half round sides, and then these random configurations to do group flashes. Whereas ours are very simply put together to where, you know, if you need to take a panel out and put another one, they're very universal.
So this is probably a good spot to pause and talk about how Fresnel lenses actually work. Overall, the basics are pretty simple. You put some kind of light source, like a lamp or a lantern, in the middle of this beehive, and then the light gets magnified by the collection of prisms. But it's really cleverly done, because not all of the prisms are designed to be the same. Some of them are designed to bend light, and others are designed to bend and reflect light. And when they all work together, you can turn any light source into a concentrated, highly magnified beam. Also, the prisms are made and arranged in such a way that only about 10% of the light gets lost. Roughly 90% of it gets concentrated into that signal. Then, to get the light to flash, there would have been panels that rotated around the Fresnel lens, regulated by the series of weights and gears. But for Big Bay Point Lighthouse in particular, no one knows where the original panels are anymore. Nick suspects that they are somewhere off the coast in Lake Superior, so. Regardless, Fresnel lenses are so well engineered that you could put a kerosene lamp in this thing, and the prisms would create a beam of light that stretched for at least 28 miles. Overall, these lenses were a huge improvement over what they used to use in US lighthouses, like the Lewis lamp or Lewis lantern. Nick described these as like crummy magnifying glasses, and I found that it wasn't uncommon for them to lose 50% of the light they produced. So about half the light didn't make it into that final beam. So by the 1860s, virtually every lighthouse in the United States had upgraded to a Fresnel lens, which was actually kind of impressive considering how expensive they were.
This was about $118,000, and it cost $25,000 to build the house.
Really though, the cost was worth it, because these things are works of art. And not just because they're so fun to look at, but because they work so incredibly well, to the point where we can't exactly replicate them in 2021.
But a really cool thing is that, you know, there's a guy now that makes these. So if any lighthouse group wants to have a lens made that's a reproduction, this is, you know, between $300,000 and $400,000 to have redone in acrylic, but it still look exactly the same. But the reason why they do that is because the crystal that these lenses are made of were all hand ground, hand polished in the day. Okay. And if you look really close on the prism, you'll see where, like, you know, the sandpaper marks basically for when they did it. The beach where the sand came from doesn't exist anymore, so they can't match the optical clarity of this crystal.
Oh.
But they found that Pyrex could do it as well as just acrylic. And, you know, there was a lighthouse in Oregon that someone had taken a sledgehammer to, and the Coast Guard was like, we're going to take this lens out. Yeah. And it took a glassmaker in the 90s with modern technology 2 years, and they could never get the light to bend. So the light goes into that prism and hits somehow, and it turns it. And they couldn't figure out with, you know, laser technology how to polish the lenses to do that. And so it took them 2 years, and they finally found that, you know, the Pyrex could bend the light properly, but normal glass can't do it. This was all designed in like 1825 to have that technology and not be able to replicate it to this day to make it any better. They can make it smaller, like with these lenses right here, but those are all using Fresnel lens technology.
It's not just that they're using Fresnel lens technology and lighthouse lights and beacons either. There is a very good chance you've encountered it in your everyday life. Like, if you've ever seen a play, Fresnel lenses are very commonly used for stage lights. They're also used on some airplanes for those overhead reading lights, since the little focused beam won't bother your neighbor. More significantly though, Fresnel lenses were also used in the headlights of virtually every US car built from at least the 1940s to the 1980s, and to some extent beyond that. They've also been used to magnify taillights and brake lights, although I couldn't find as much information on how common that is now. Still, if you've ever driven in an older car at night, or have just driven around and not had somebody rear-end you, you might have Fresnel lenses to thank. Beyond that, Fresnel lenses have been used for everything from landing systems on aircraft carriers to blind spot mirrors for semi-trucks, all the way to spacecraft. Like in the 1990s, tiny Fresnel lenses were used to concentrate sunlight and focus it onto the solar cells that powered the Deep Space One mission, which visited an asteroid and a comet. And it probably won't surprise you that lighthouses around the world are still using Fresnel technology, even if they're not using their original lens. That's true at Big Bay Point as well, although Nick found quite the replacement to put in his tower.
Man, you've got a cool house.
And this is our current light right here. So
hello.
We have two light systems here because we are a marking station. We do always have to have a light here. So we have our main light here, which is a really, really sweet 1934 US Lighthouse Service Airway Division beacon. A lot of airports will have these lights. And a cool thing about them is that they're just extremely reliable, but they still use Fresnel technology. So as I rotate this real quick, I'll turn it on for you here shortly. But it uses one light source and magnifies through two Fresnel lenses. So there's a middle Fresnel lens, and it uses all these prisms on the outside to give a 64 mile range. I'll kick the light on for you so you guys can see. It's gonna have a little noise to it.
All right.
But we're the only lighthouse that actually uses one of these now in the United States. When airmail became popular, so that you could get stuff between San Francisco and Washington, D.C., large arrows were put between, and then lighthouse keepers' homes. Every 25 miles, they had a keeper's house. Then they had a skeleton tower with one of these on it. You can still get these. They're all going to be refurbished. They're $30,000, but you have to give them one in exchange.
Oh.
And so this came up on eBay, and it was just one of those, oh my gosh. But you can kind of see over here how the bullseyes work for this.
So do you have that sheet up there just to see what the light's looking like?
So people complain. So this light can be seen. You can see Big Bay over there. You can see the harbor.
Okay.
Or not the harbor, but the water tower. So that's the heart of downtown. And believe it or not, this does shine into someone's house over there. And they do complain about it. So traditionally, though, with the Fresnel lens, you would have curtains that would go up all the time.
Oh, okay.
And so they would have the curtains up. If the sun came through, it would magnify just like if you did, you know, to spiders or whatever. It will melt anything inside the lens, so the lamp change or anything like that. And then if it was one that rotated with bullseyes, it would cause forest fires. So sun would shine through and it'd just be at the angle and, you know, catch a tree, or a lot of lighthouses are on bluffs and, you know, there'd be a bluff behind it and, you know, catch all that stuff on fire. So
what I loved about hanging out with Nick wasn't just that he's wildly knowledgeable. I also really admire the way he approaches being a lighthouse keeper. He talked about lighthouses in a way I've never seen anyone do before, and it really stuck with me. So as we wind down, I'll leave you with this.
We have a lot of history in our country, and a lot of people don't understand the sacrifices that lighthouse keepers gave because they were military service as well. And a lot of them didn't live out here with their families, and their families lived other places. So when you go to a lighthouse, just remember, you know, the history behind it, and that, you know, it's still doing its job, but the people gave their lives, you know, basically to ensure that the people at sea, you know, were safe. And, you know, they didn't care about themselves or their families. It was about keeping this light going. And it's not just a building. It's, you know, it's a piece of history. I own the lighthouse, but I don't. I'm really just someone filling the space until I die and someone else comes in, you know? So my due diligence is to just keep this place as maintained as I can. Obviously, I just painted this not too long ago. Look at all this stuff up here. It didn't take long. So, yeah.
And that really just sums up my experience with Nick Korstad and Big Bay Point Lighthouse. Nick had such wonderful, thoughtful things to say about the building, and then he went right back to taking care of it. As always, thanks for joining me for this adventure. If you liked this video and want to see more of them, the two most significant things you can do are to share this video, or if you're interested and able, to consider supporting my work on Patreon. I am constantly so grateful for the folks over there, and their kindness and generosity are literally what make field shoots like this possible. One way or another though, thank you for being here. I hope you learned something that makes you think about the world just a little bit differently, and I'll see you soon.